Pastor Valerie Holcomb would like to welcome our Christian House of Prayer family, along with our first-time and returning visitors, to this morning's service. We're honored that you chose to worship with us today and pray that you'll consider worshiping with us again right here at the Christian House of Prayer, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ.
Good morning, Christian House of Prayer. All that can stand, please stand as we go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Abba Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you for this day. For this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. So let us enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Father, we thank you that you are loving, caring, sharing, Heavenly Father. And we know that our identity is in divinity and knowing who you are. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the author and the finisher of our faith. The great I am, the Ancient of Days, the lily in the valley and the bright and morning star. You're the good shepherd, the great shepherd and the chief shepherd, the shepherd and the bishop of our soul. You're the healer, you're a provider, and the protector, oh God. You're wonderful, counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And we give you and you alone all the glory, all the honor, all the adoration, and all the praise. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for our pastor, a pastor that you have given us after your own heart, Pastor Valerie Holcomb, a pastor that feeds us with knowledge and understanding, that rightly divides the word of truth, that has the tongue of the learned, and whose speech is seasoned with salt. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord God, that you continue, Lord Jesus, to use her as a polished shaft in your quiver, oh God. Let no weapon formed against her prosper, and any tongue that rise up against her in judgment that you will condemn. We ask, oh God, that you continue to anoint her from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Continue to bless her and anoint her family, Father God. Her children and then her children's children from generation to generation. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for we have prayed for the sinners, Father God, those that have backslidden, Father God, and those to become a part of this great church, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, that you have sent your Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but through him, oh God, that we might be saved. We thank you, oh God, that we are, hallelujah. We thank you, oh God, that we are pilgrims and strangers traveling through this land, Father God, waiting to see you, oh God. So we thank you, oh God, that as we go along the way, if we have dropped the axe head anointing, Father God, that the rule and the work and the witness of your Holy Spirit, that we go back, pick it up, and continue to go call you, Father God. For your word says you are married to the backslider, oh God. So we thank you, oh God. And we understand, Father God, that it's not who we're turning from, but who we're going to, oh God. It is you, oh God, our Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, oh God, for your word, Father God. And Psalms 33 that said how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. For where there is unity, oh God, you command blessings. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the eldership, the deaconship, the leadership, and the membership of this Christian House of Prayer. How we are fitly joined together as one body, speaking the same thing, having the same mind, same love, same earnest care. We have the same judgment. We have the same, we're walking the same steps. We have the same spirit. We have the same spirit of faith. We live by the same measure of rule, and we walk by the same diligence, oh God. So we say, anoint to each and every one, Father God. Enlarge our territory. Let no weapon formed against us prosper in any tongue that rise up against us in judgment you condemn. We thank you, oh God, that we know that, Father God, in James, Father God, it says, oh God, no matter the tests, trials, and tribulations that comes our way, Father God, we count it all joy because we know that the end that we will win. For it is written in the strip, victory belongs to us. So we're not going to shout when the battle's over. We're going to shout right now. Hallelujah. So we ask, oh God, Holy Spirit, have your way in this place right now, Father God. Move like ever before. Hallelujah, Jesus. We ask, Lord God, that you break every chain, Father God. You loose the bondage, Father God, that the sins that are easily beset us, Father God, so that we may go and we may reach the mark, Father God. Father God, we pray, Lord Jesus, that you continue to strengthen us, Father God, and you anoint each and every one, Father God. In your mighty name we pray. And we thank you, O God. And all the people said it, hallelujah, hallelujah and amen.
Good morning, Christian House of Prayer. It is a good thing to give praise and thanks unto our God and to sing unto his glorious name. Have you come to worship him today? Have you come to give our God a high praise? We lift up a shout of hallelujah and we sing unto your name, oh God. Glory to your name.
For all people from every land to come together. Now is the moment for worship. We enter in with holding nothing. He's worthy, exalted. He's high and lifted up. Sing, sing unto the
holy hands unashamed. Sing, sing
with our song of praise, we lift up a hallelujah to your name. Hallelujah to the King of Kings, and hallelujah to the Lord of Lords. It is to you, O God, we give our praise. You are our sustainer, our supplier. You have met every one of our needs, and we give you this sacrifice of praise. Hallelujah.
I will sing hallelujah. I will sing, oh Lord, I will sing hallelujah. I
Lord Jesus.
Please stand as we declare the 91st Psalm. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him, and show him my salvation. Just a friendly reminder, please remember to wear your mask during the entire service and practice social distancing during worship and as you move throughout the sanctuary. Thank you. Join us online Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for a hallmark message from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb. Rehearse a word that you've heard as we stay connected in this season. Log on to chop.org, cciCovenant.com, YouTube, and Facebook every Wednesday night at 7 p.m.
Praise the Lord, saints. This is Elder Solomon. On behalf of Pastor Valerie Holcomb, I want to invite all of CHOP family, all those that are prayers, for a time of prayer. This is a prayer call starting this coming Friday at 6 to 7 p.m. We will be out in the parking lot, walking around. We'll hear the prayer. You can put the prayer. You can find us on Facebook. We'll have prayers inside praying, but all of us will be outside this coming Friday, October the 30th. And then on Saturday is our regular intercessory prayer. We'll do the same thing from 9 to 10 a.m. And then on Sunday, we'll close it out. It is the hour of prayer. This is what our pastor had called us to do. This is what the Lord has led her to do. And so we want to join forces. We want to bind our faith together and seek the face of the Lord as it concerns this country, this state, and this city. And the cities around Killeen, Copper's Cove, Temple. We want to pray. We want God's will. We want to pray for the peace of God as we approach this election time. We want the peace of God. And whatever outcome of the election will be, our hearts will be so settled. our hearts would be so at peace because we're doing what the scripture tells us to do according to 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, God says that he will hear from heaven. He will hear us. And so we want to pray. We want to seek God's face. We want to calm and quiet our spirits as this time of transition of our country approaches. We want to pray. We want to be found praying and believing God. And we're asking the Father to let your will be done, your kingdom come, as we would pray. Join us this coming Friday. Thank you. I'll see you there. God bless you.
The Christian House of Prayer invites you to come and worship with us every Sunday morning at 10 a.m. Come and enjoy the Word, the worship, and the presence of God as we adjust to our new normal. We've taken all precautions and we're following CDC guidelines to make your worship experience as safe as possible. Interested in worshiping with us? Log on to CHOP.org tomorrow morning beginning at 9 a.m. and click the Reservations tab to reserve your seat. Upon arrival of service, please wear your mask and be prepared to have your temperature checked and sanitization complete before entering the service. The Christian House of Prayer is doing the practical to keep all of our members as safe as possible. Come worship with us next Sunday at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ. Give your tithes, offerings, and gifts of love with ease at the Christian House of Prayer. Give online at CHOP.org or on the CHOP app. Give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Coppers Cove, Texas 76522. Give Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. in our Cove location at 916 West Highway 190. Give on Wednesdays in the Colleen location from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. and Sunday mornings from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. in the foyer. Give at the Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union's Night Depository Box 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Let's continue to do the practical, and God will continue to do the providential in this season. The last day to participate in early voting will be this coming Friday, October 30th. If you haven't had a chance to vote, avoid the lines on Election Day and vote early. Visit your county website for polling locations and hours of operations. The Refuge Corporation would like to say thank you to the Christian House of Prayer family for your financial support with the mobile food pantry distribution. This month, we served 430 families, 146 new families, and a total of 1,351 individuals. None of this would be possible without your faithful support.
Good morning, Christian House of Prayer, to both that are here and to those that are tuned in. God bless you. And it's time to worship God in the giving of our tithes, offering, and our gifts of love. Family, we want to thank you for your faithfulness in the givings of your tithes and offerings and gift. It shows God that you have moved from faith to confidence in Him. God is not bound by a pandemic of what sinner man may say. His word is the only thing that he hastens to perform.
I've seen since this pandemic promotions. I've seen new homes being bought. I've seen pay raises and family members prosper. I've seen new cars. And someone might ask, how is this possible? It's possible because when you follow the principles of giving and honor God with your tithes and offering and gifts of love, he says in Malachi 3:10, stop and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven, pour you out a blessing that you won't have room enough to receive. He goes on to tell us that he will rebuke the devourer for our name's sake. Amen. So we thank God for this opportunity to give to his purpose and to his cause. Jesus said in Luke 6:38, give, and it should be given unto you. Good measures, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. Giving, as you support the kingdom of God, it advances the cause of God in our lives. Lives are being transformed and changed by the power of God because of your faithfulness and confidence in him. In the book of Acts, Paul in the 18th chapter arrives in Corinth. And while in Corinth, his money is kind of funny. In other words, he's low on cash. But he runs into a couple by the name of Priscilla and Aquila, who are tent makers by trade. Paul and Priscilla and Aquila begin to make tents so that their daily needs can be met. Amen. Paul was willing to work. But after a while, Timothy and Silas shows up, and they come with a good report from the Philippian church, how that the church is prospering and how that they're doing well. And they bring with them a gift, a love gift for the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul ceased from tent making and began to devote himself to full-time ministry because of the gifts of the saints. So, amen, but my God, Paul says, shall supply all our needs according to his riches and glory. Amen, your giving today helps advance the kingdom. And Paul tells the Corinthian church and the Philippian church that God take copious notes and it is credited to your account as you give. So don't ever think your giving is in vain. Let us pray. Eternal God and Father, we thank you now for those that gave and those that have a desire to give and have not. We ask that you would bless them, some 30, some 60, and some 100-fold. We thank you now for this opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Please stand and follow the instructions of the deacons as we receive our tithes and offerings and declare our confession of faith. People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 o'clock in Killeen, our Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock in Killeen, and any other service that we might have. Every need in this ministry is met, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what he hath promised, he was able also to perform. In Jesus' name, amen, and amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is high and lifted up, and his train fills the temple. Don't you feel his presence this morning? Don't you feel the presence of the Lord in this place? Amen. You may have your seats. Good morning, Christian House of Prayer. Thank God for your faithfulness in pressing your way out to the house of the Lord this morning. We call this the living room of God. And I want to say welcome to all of our family there on streaming. We are praying for you, and I'm looking forward to the day that we're all back under one roof, Father. I need my family. I love my family. Hallelujah. But in the meantime, we've been praying your safety. We've been praying that God will touch you in a way that you'll know that he's there with you as well. Amen. We're here in the house of prayer this morning, and I'm so thankful. I'm so glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I don't take it for granted, because we could be making funeral arrangements for somebody today, but we are in the house of the Lord, alive and well. Hallelujah. Amen. I want to thank the Lord for Deacon Sneed. Didn't he pray this morning? You could pray for us anytime. And from the parking lot to the pulpit, all of the nurses out there, our group that's signing everybody in, the orchestra, the praise and the worship. I tell you, when we praise the Lord the way we did this morning, shekels fall off. We begin to increase our faith in God. That's what praise and worship is supposed to do. It brings us into the presence of the Lord. And I'll tell you, they brought us in this morning. They brought us in. Hallelujah. They brought us in. I would like to ask if there are any first-time visitors here in the Christian House of Prayer. You're here for the very first time. If you don't mind, would you stand? Would you stand? Just stand so we can see who you are. Hallelujah. I see one, two. All right. All right. Let's give them a great big hand. Hallelujah. We want to let you know that we are so honored that you saw fit. The Holy Spirit drew you here to the Christian House of Prayer this morning, and we don't take it for granted. We ask you to, if it's anything that you need, you have these men, handsome men standing in the aisle or behind you, or even somebody next to you. If it's something that you need, let us know so that you can worship with us the way we just let our hair down. We just believe in just taking it all off and letting the Holy Spirit have his way. So we are so honored that you're here this morning. God bless you. You're welcome, and you're welcome to any of our services. Amen. God bless you, people of God. Let's give them another hand. Amen. I wanted to let everybody know this morning, you know, as I said a few weeks ago, I can't get up and tell... mention everyone that had lost ones in their home, in their families. But I did want to mention Elder Alex Hilliard. His mother went on to be with the Lord on last week, and they had the funeral on Friday. Amen. Let me look around. Let me just look around at the people of God. Let me just look around and thank God. I tell you, I am so honored to be among faithful. I mean, I believe you are some of the most faithful, dedicated people. And I mean that. I'm not just trying to stand up here and find something to say. I mean that with all of my heart. Because I could be in the midst of some mean rattlesnakes. And I could be, but God saw, I mean, he kissed us. He kissed us. Amen. He kissed us. I want y'all to keep my mother up in prayer. She's challenged. And last week we had to talk about some things to the doctor, and my sister and I, my brother, we're standing in faith because we know that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord will deliver us out of them all. We also know that it's a time to be born and it's a time to die. And even though we know that absent from the body, we're present with the Lord, but it still hurts our emotions, it hurts our mind, and it causes us to go into maybe a season that we haven't had maybe in a long time. So when I was talking to the doctor on last week, and my mother and me and that Bishop, we all have the same doctor, Dr. Legan. If you're out there, Dr. Legan, looking, God bless you. And as I was, we were talking to him on streaming and on virtual. He said, I said, how you doing, Dr. Legan? I said, you know, I'm praying about him. He's a Christian. I said, I need you to pray for my back. I said, you know, I need you to pray. He said, I know what's going to be out. He said, that's your stress area. So I said, well, you know what? Glory be to God. I said, you know, I'm going to give the devil, I'm going to smack him in his face. And I'm going to go in there and I'm going to take me some medicine to help me along the way. And so I'm good now, but if I stumble a little bit, if I seem a little off, don't pay that no mind. Because when we weak, that's when we are strong. Amen? Amen. So let's stand to our feet this morning. And I want you to open up your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 11. And we're going to read the King James Version and also the Living Bible Version of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And I mean that, Christian House of Prayer. I tell you, I talk to pastors. And every time when they be telling me, you know what I mean? I said, really, I'll tell you the truth. I said, I feel ashamed that I can't say the same. I said, sometimes I'm just embarrassed that I can't say nothing bad about this church. And then I turn around and I say, well, you know what? I'm not embarrassed. I give God the glory. I give him the praise. I give him the honor. Amen. So I'm full this morning. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, it reads, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Now, the Living Bible, look at what the Living Bible say. You can never please God without faith, without depending on him. Anyone who wants to come to God must believe that there is a God, and that he rewards those who sincerely look to please him. Hallelujah. I put the please in. I added that in, to please him. Because if we sincerely look into him, we're going to please him, right? Amen. Hallelujah. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his word. And I want you to turn to the person next to you and say, faith first. Faith first. Hallelujah. Jesus is the center and circumference, the base and the boundary, the balance and the beauty, the sum and the substance of what our lives are all about. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. You may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. Yes, if we sincerely look for him, we are pleasing him. Anyone that sincerely want to please God is a person that sincerely want to grow up. I'm going to say it again. Anyone that sincerely want to please God is a person that sincerely want to grow up. Because it's only when we grow up that we can be trusted with the keys of the kingdom. Because the harvest is plenteous. The harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And the reason why the laborers are few is because the laborers, us as the laborers, including myself, we all have to grow up so that he can use us in the capacity that he wants to use us. Can anybody say amen?
Amen.
We need the axe head anointing. Now, this is the 18th part, But it's the second part of measure. We're going to measure the measure of our faith. This is the second part. But we're leading, we're heading towards confidence. Confidence. Now, we have to grow up. A few years ago, we talked about we have to grow up before we go up. And so, go up might not necessarily mean to die. But to go up to the dimension that God wants us and the level that God wants us to be on as ministers of the gospel, because we're all ministers. God has anointed and deputized every one of us to be ministers of the gospel. Regardless if it's just one person that God would give you to lead to the Lord or to make an influence in their lives, or thousands of people, it doesn't matter. But our purpose for living is to glorify Him. And in order to glorify Him, we have to grow up. Now I want you to go with me into your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 through 13. Hallelujah. Because for us to please God, it's going to take a little bit. Don't you think so? It's going to take a little bit on our behalf. It's going to take a little for us to get to where we need to go. Amen? All right, is it on the Jumbotron? As it is written, and we're talking about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's influence in our lives, the axe head anointing represents the Holy Spirit. It represents the cutting edge, the anointing, where when we have the Holy Spirit's influence in our life, then we're not taking the axe handle and trying to take the axe handle to cut down things in our lives. Things that we don't want, things that the Lord don't want us to have, things that we don't want to have. And people are taking the handle. An axe head is the head of an axe. You know what an axe looks like. It has a handle and it has a head. Now, when people are not getting out of their life what they want out of their life, it's like taking the handle of the axe head and hitting at a tree, just hitting at it, trying to pull it down. But until you use the axe head, which is the sharp part of the axe, you take that axe head and you begin to hit that tree. And it might take a while, but you just do a little bit, you just do a little bit at a time, and you keep letting that drop into the bucket. But sooner or later, the bucket is going to get full. And when it gets full and overflowing, that's the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the yoke-destroying, burden-removing power of God. In other words, the Holy Spirit is the enabler. The Holy Spirit is here in the earth realm to help us do what we need to do and to live this Christian life that God has left us down here to live. So here we have in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 to 13. Let's read it. But as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Even the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God know of no man but the spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in words which with man's wisdom teacheth, but who? The Holy Ghost. Now who? The Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. So the Holy Spirit is the teacher of the church. The Holy Spirit, he from the Father, he gives the preacher what to preach. Now, if the people come to hear what the preacher is preaching from the Logos, the Word of God, then the Spirit will tell us what he's saying to us individually through a rhema, a personal Word of God. See, when I come with a word, I can only come with one word. But the Holy Spirit, he has the power and the anointing to go to everybody's life, everybody's situation, and tell them how this message is going to help you in your life. Words to live by. Amen. Now, the main thing is that we come as prepared listeners, because the Holy Spirit's job is to change our character. It's to change. We have to have a new way of thinking, a new way of reasoning, looking at things in a different way. Amen. And so go to 2 Corinthians now, chapter 3 and verse 18. Because the Holy Spirit's job is he's working on us to change us into the image of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In other words, when we go back around our friends that used to know us, they'll say, you know, there's something different about her. There's something different about him. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 says, but we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as the Spirit of the Lord. So the Holy Spirit helps us. The process of this change is called sanctification, as we change into the image and in the likeness of God. And you know, God is so, he's so creative that he leaves us with our own personalities. Now, we have our own personalities. And he'll use us. If you're a person that's funny, he'll change you in his image, but you'll still be a funny person. Brother Stu here, Brother Stu just got back from his mother's funeral. Brother Stu here. He's not here. I spoke to him on last night. Brother Stu, he's funny. I mean, if I look at Stu, I start laughing. He don't have to say a word. But God uses that personality, even though he's been changed in the image and the likeness of God, but he still uses our personalities. Amen. The best us come out. Amen. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit is changed. We are being changed to the image and in the likeness of God. And this is called sanctification. Because we can't produce the character of Jesus on our own. We don't, not our own strength, not our own ability. See, we can stay at home or even come to church. And you could sit in one of them chairs or come up here and sit and read the Bible from, you know, I always say contents to maps. You can read it and read it and read it. But until the word reads you. See, you read it, but then the word reads you. And when the word reads you and you look into the mirror of God's word, when you're really looking in it, you'll see how much we need to change. We'll see how much we need him even more than our necessary food. We need him. We need him in the morning. We need him in the afternoon. We need him at night. We need him when we're sleeping. We don't know what's going on. We need the Lord. We need the Lord. And so we can't produce character in and of ourselves. We can read all the self-help books they got out, but it's not going to change your character until we allow the ministry of the Holy Spirit through the Word of God, through the Rhema of God, through the Logos of God, that will change us, that we are now, we move into sanctification, where we are sanctified, set apart, meet for the Master's use, and prepared for every good work, every good work. See, many times we're thinking about the good work is behind the pulpit. up here. No, the good work is in your house. The good work is on your job. The good work is wherever we go, whoever we come in contact with, whoever calls us, you know, whoever is in distress, whoever, you know, whoever needs help. When you think about somebody coming to pray with you, you think about a certain kind of person. You think about a sanctified person. I'm not going to call on somebody that they need help. I'm not going to get in the boat, but they in the same boat I'm in. You're going to call for somebody that's been sanctified, somebody that's been changed in the image and in the likeness of God. It's only through the Holy Spirit can we change. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13 in the King James Version, it says, "For it is God which worketh in me both to will and to do of his good pleasure." And then in Philippians chapter 2 and 13, in the New Living Translation, it says, "For God is working in you, giving you the desire and power to do what pleases him." I like that. Philippians 2 and 13 in the New Living Bible. "For God is working in you." Don't you want God to work in you? "Giving you the desire and power to do what pleases him." It's amazing to me how God has given us what we need to please him. Isn't that amazing? I mean, God has given us what we need to please him. We just have to let him help us. We have to let the Holy Spirit help us so that we can please God. Amen. We need the help of the Holy Ghost even to activate our faith. And to activate our faith, we have to do what? We do something, say something, or give something. Now go to Romans chapter 12, verse 13, and we're going to begin to get into what we need to talk about today. The axe head anointing is the Spirit of God, is the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. Romans chapter 12, Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 3. "For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think." Now, he didn't say don't think high, but he said don't think more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. So God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. And as we said last week, that every person that's born into this world, they have a measure of faith. See, if a person, when you came in here today, and you know we operate in confidence and faith all the time. When you came in here this morning, even the visitors, when y'all came in here this morning, you have faith that when you sat in this chair, that this chair was going to hold you. You didn't think about if this chair is going to hold you. You just came right on in here and you pulled it down and you just flopped right down in that chair and the chair held you. See, that's confidence and faith coupled together. Now, those that's members of the Christian House of Prayer, you have confidence in these chairs because you sit in these chairs week after week. So you have confidence. But you have faith when you came in, you have faith. But the moment we receive Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, he gives us the measure of faith. God has dealt to every born-again believer, the measure of faith. Because back to Hebrews chapter 6, 11, 6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Amen. So this is the amazing thing, is God has given us enough faith to please him. I mean, even as a newborn babe in Christ, you have enough faith to please him. Hebrews chapter 11, chapter 12, verse 2, because Jesus, when we say the measure of faith, and we talked about this last week, the measure of faith, it has to be Jesus. We started off with, is the beginning Jesus, is the end Jesus, is all in between Jesus. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. So the measure of faith is we got to receive Jesus. We got to depend on Jesus. We got to look unto Jesus. Jesus is the word personified. And so we have to have Jesus on our minds in order for us to be able to operate in this measure of faith. We have to get it down in our bed, in the bedrock of our heart, that what pleases God is that we receive Jesus. Amen. We please God when we're loving Jesus, when we're leaning on Jesus, when we're learning of Jesus, when we're lifting Jesus up, when we're living for Jesus. This pleases God. This is the measure of faith. Amen. Again, God's standard is not performance. He's not looking for performance. He's not looking for performance, but what he's looking for is perfection. And we know that over in Romans, it says that the good and the acceptable and the perfect will of God. Now, we know perfect means maturity. Maturity. So this is the reason why we have to have it in our minds and our hearts that I'm going all the way with him. 99 and a half just not going to do for me. I'm going all the way with Jesus. I'm going all the way with them. Because the Father has put, he's given us all that we need. When we got saved, we got all the Jesus we're going to get. But what we have to do is we have to learn about the Jesus that we have. And the more we know him, the more we love him. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. It gets sweeter and sweeter as the day go by, falling in love between my Lord and I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Because unless we keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. Do you realize that when a person first gets saved, they so upstairs, I mean, they bouncing off the wall. They so excited about the Lord, they bouncing off the wall. And, you know, every time you see them, they telling you about the goodness of the Lord. But the danger is when after a time then pass by and people get complacent, you know, the excitement of Jesus. But see, if you have this measure of faith and you operating in this measure of faith, you'll keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over. You know, it just gets sweeter. It gets sweeter and sweeter. Because when you get older in the Lord, when you grow up in the Lord, when you look around at the goodness of the Lord, when you go in your closet and you see your clothes, you know, one time you didn't have nothing. You look at your house, you know, one time you didn't have a nice house like you got now. You just keep falling in love with them over and over and over and over again. Hallelujah. The pastor's responsibility is to feed the people with knowledge and with understanding. It says in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 15. But the pastor is not to feed you with junk food. See, the pastor's not going to feed you with junk food. That's the reason why when the pastor preach, you might not be flipping around and all that stuff. Because the pastor not going to feed you with junk food. Meaning that there will be a time, there's going to be a time in our lives when you're going to need what's being preached. You might not need it today, but you might need it next week. You might not need it for yourself. But you might need it for somebody else. You might need it. You might not need it for you, but you might need it for your children. And so the pastor, his job or her job is to feed you with knowledge and with understanding And then you take the word and you feed it to your faith. You feed it to your faith. And then you begin to grow. As you act on the word of God, you begin to grow. Hallelujah. Then the people that does this, you see fruit that's abound to their account. Because if we are moving out and we are operating in that measure of faith, then there will be fruit that will abound to our account. We will see the fruit everywhere. And we know, we talked about this already, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, but write it down. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Against such there is no law. So if we operating in this measure of faith, then the fruit will come forth in our life. The way we used to act, we don't act like that no more. When we used to go off the handle, we don't go off the handle no more. When you want to give a person a piece of your mind, and I stopped giving the people a piece of my mind because I don't have enough right now. I can't afford to give nobody a piece of my mind. I need all my mind. We don't do it no more. The things that used to tick us off, we don't do it no more. You know why? Because when we have the fruit of the Spirit operating in our lives and we have this relationship with Jesus, then we go to the rock that is higher than us. When we're disappointed, when we're mystified and we don't know what to do, we go to the rock that is higher than I. Because we may tremble on the rock, but the rock ain't never going to tremble under us. God has given us enough faith to please him. This measure of faith, it carries us so that we will grow. And there's seven steps even in our growth. We saved by faith. Ephesians chapter 2 and 8 says, for by grace are we saved through faith. That's Ephesians 2 and 8. We live by faith. By faith. Romans chapter 1 and 17 says, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. We walk by faith. Romans chapter 10 and verse 8 says, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. We walk by faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7, for we walk by faith and not by sight. We fight by faith. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 12 says, fight the good fight of faith. We overcome by faith. 1 John chapter 5 verse 4 says, for whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. We are faithful unto death. Revelation chapter 2 and 10 says, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some into your prison, that ye may be tried. And ye shall have tribulation. In other words, in life, we shall have tribulation. It says 10 days. But thou be faithful unto death. I will give thee a crown of life. From the cradle to the grave. We ought to praise him. From the cradle to the grave, we depend upon him. The measure of faith will take us all the way to the end, till we take our last breath. This measure can hold us. Now, without the measure of faith in operations in our life, we're under the snake line. We under that snake line where there's not a life of victory. And without this measure of faith growing up, this is what you'll have: murmuring and complaining, whining, crying, arguing, fussing, fighting, fretting, disobedience, stubbornness, backbiting, gossiping, criticizing, negativism, jealousy, envy, strife, coveting, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, fornication, adultery, idolatry, homosexuality, lesbianism, incest, and bestiality, and all the forms of pornography. This is what we will have without the measure of faith, without walking in the measure of faith. Galatians chapter 5, verse 24 and 25 says, "And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit." And we living in the Spirit, we in the Spirit, because God gave us the Holy Spirit. When before Jesus left, he said, "I'm going to pray to the Father that he send us the Holy Ghost that will help us as we live this journey we call life." Hallelujah. 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 Praise his name. Now, if we are operating in faith, in the measure of faith, faith that's not tested cannot be trusted. Faith that's not tested cannot be trusted. In other words, you don't know. You don't know what you'll do if that happened. But once it happened, then you'll know if the fruit of the Spirit, if you're abiding on the vine. Go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Faith that's not tested cannot be trusted. We have to pass the test of life. If not, we will keep on having to take this test over and over again. We have to pass the test of life. Because if not, you're going to have to keep taking that same test over and over and over again. Now here in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, it says, "Examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know you not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobate." Now this word reprobate comes from the Greek word adakamios, adakimes. And it means rejected after testing. It means flunked the faith test. See, if before you were just hot-tempered, and the Lord is, the Holy Spirit trying to get you to tame that down. See, if we intend to have the fruit of the Spirit operating in our life, certain things we're going to be tested. And so if somebody made you mad, let's just use that. Somebody made you angry. And before, you would go off. You would just go off on them. Now that you're born again, you should know you ain't supposed to be doing that now. You need to know that that's not the character of Christ. And so if you flunk that test and if you go on and do it, you know it. You know what you're not supposed to do, but you do it anyway. That's a reprobate. Because you have been rejected after the test. So now what you got to do, now you got to go back to God. "Oh God, I'm sorry. I knew I shouldn't have did it." The good, the acceptable, and the perfect. See, we don't want to be on the good. That's the good. We've been on good too long. Even when we say, "I'm doing better." It got to the point I said, "No, I'm doing better." No, you ought to be perfect by now. We ought to be walking in maturity by now. Amen. So when you don't pass that test, that gives the devil, your enemy, my enemy, the opportunity to just rake you out, just make you feel like you're just a heel. You don't love God. You're stupid. You're out of control. You know, you don't even deserve to be reading the Bible and praying. See, he'll bring that condemnation on you. And this is the reason why we have to want to grow up. Because nobody can make you grow up. Nobody can do it. I can't do it. I don't care who you get up here to preach. Nobody can make you obey the word of God. Only you can do that. I don't want to get off my subject, but even our confession brings forth our possession, and we'll have whatsoever we say. But nobody's voice is more powerful than your own. When you hear yourself, when you hear yourself operating on the level that I'm referring to, when I can say, you know, you shouldn't do that because that's the test that you didn't pass. But if you say it out loud, God, I ask to be forgiven. That's a test I didn't pass. But Father, the next time I'm going to pass this test. So you got to call those things that be not as though they were. Because if you never, if your confession, the words that you speak, it comes to the level of your faith. Your faith will never rise above the level of your confession. If your confession is negativism, then you will always have negative things happening in your life. If your mind is always critical, you will always have the devil coming against your mind. So the measure of faith is to flow in and out of every area of our life. And the first thing that has to happen when a person first gets saved is you got to get your words. Your words have to change. You got to homologeo. You got to speak the same thing. Homo, same. Logeo, speak what God speaks. Speak what Jesus speaks through his word. If things are not happening the way you want them to happen, then you go to the word. If it's one of your children, Father, I thank you, Lord Father. Father, I believe that my child is born again, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. I thank you, Father, that the same Holy Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, let it dwell in my child. Let my child see Jesus in me. Let my child see the love of God that's been shed abroad in my heart. And my child, I look attractive to my child because Jesus is in me. See, we have to go to the word of God. We have to pray the word of God. We got to speak it out of our own mouth. Because God, he framed the world by the words that he spoke. He spoke the world into existence by the words that he spoke. Amen? And so we don't want to be rejected after testing. We want to pass the test. Faith is not tested. It cannot be trusted. Because the devil comes with his plot, his plans, and his ploys. And he know the button to hit. But when you are exercising this measure of faith, and that devil see he can't get you in that area no more, he'll flee from you. Resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. He will flee. Because there is more power. God has given us more power than the devil. He said, I have given you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And then he says, by no means will it hurt you. But see, the devil, he tries to get us to hurt ourselves. That's what he does. And when he tries to get us to hurt ourselves, it come out in different ways. Physical ways. Now you got an ailment that you didn't have before. Now you got it. Why? Because you didn't take the measure of faith and hold that word up against the devil until it breaks. You hold it up until it breaks. And when it breaks in you, the devil gotta flee. He gotta go. He gotta flee. Amen. So the purpose of living is to glorify God. And when we glorify God, the test becomes easier to pass. It becomes easier to pass. Now Jesus said in Mark 11:22, to have faith in God. Have faith in God. Now if we resist that, then what we are I hate to say it, but we're babies. We could be a 40-year-old baby. We could be a 50-year-old baby. We could be a 60, 70, 80. We could be a 100-year-old baby. Because this is some of the attributes a baby always had. A baby's feelings get hurt. If you look at a baby a certain way, you're just trying to smile, but you're doing a little funny face. Baby's feelings get hurt. Babies need attention all the time. Babies always stink, poop, poop in the pamper. They stink. They always stink. The baby put everything in their mouth. Anything. That's why we got to take heed to what we hear. We got to take heed to what we put in our spiritual heart. The baby can't talk, but it always cries all the time. A baby can't talk. A baby cannot reason with you because it doesn't have the mental capacity to form a sentence in its mouth. It cries all the time. And so as Christians, we don't want to be Christian babies. We want to grow up in the Lord. Can I hear somebody say amen? Amen. Now going back to 2 Corinthians chapter 13, 2. This scripture, a lot of times when we minister on this scripture, we say examine ourselves, and truly when Paul wrote this, he wrote this because he knew that it was going to be needful and mindful for more than the Corinthian church. And it blessed me when Minister Prater had talked about the Corinthian church giving Paul this offering, because the Corinthian church was a church that was up today and down the next day. They went in and out. It is even the Corinthian churches were the one that says that one man had an affair with his father's wife. And they said, throw him out the church, throw him out. He said, but then bring him back in so his soul would be saved. But they had problems up and down, in and out. And so here in 2 Corinthians, this is what Paul is writing to the Corinthians church. And I'm going to tell you what they did. He says, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know you not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobates. Now, Paul was writing to them, this church, because the Corinthians church was having doubt. And they were doubting Paul's authenticity as an apostle. There were some false teachers that came into the church, and they began to tell the Corinthian people, Paul ain't got the word. Paul don't have the gospel. They said Paul is weak. They said, Paul, read it. Read all of 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Read it all tonight. Now, it's not written there what these false apostles and false teachers were saying, but you know what they were saying by what Paul was saying. But these false teachers, they were false apostles. They pawned themselves off to be apostles. And they came into this church, and they were doing this all over. They were doing it in Galatia too. As Paul would go to the church to preach the gospel, these ministers, false prophets, would come in after Paul and begin to preach another doctrine. And so here they were telling Paul, they said, we don't know whether you know apostle, because your message is weak. You weak, your message is weak, and you look weak, you dressing weak. Because if you look at it, if you read it, he said these people came in there with these nice clothes on. They had this voice of authority. They came in there. And Paul said, you know, I didn't take your money. He said, they taking your money. He said, they doing all kinds of things to you, and you questioning me? In 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and 3, it says, this is what Paul is saying to them. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, 3, he says, since you seek a proof of Christ speaking in me, which to you word is not weak, but is mighty in you. He said, now, are you telling me I was the one that came and shared Jesus with you? I'm the one that helped this that church be erected. And he's saying, if I'm a false apostle, then you a false Christian. That's what Paul was saying. Paul was saying, if I'm a false apostle, then you a false Christian. Because I know whom I have believed. And so he was talking to him. He was saying, so this was his test. I'm bringing this out because this was Paul's test. And all of us is going to be tested in our lives. You know, Paul, he was outdone. If you read the whole thing, Paul was outdone because not only did Paul, all he preached was Jesus. It was just Jesus. Look, Jesus in the morning, he know what happened to him on that road to the of Damascus. He know what happened. But Paul even had a thorn in the flesh. And Paul said, I asked the Lord to take it out several times, but the Lord said, my grace is sufficient in thee. In your weakness, you keep on keeping on. Paul said, you need to examine your faith. Because if I'm not an apostle, you're not a Christian. Now think about how that would have made you feel. That's a test. That's a test. But Paul passed the test. Paul didn't even go. He was supposed to have went to the Corinthians church, but he tarried back until those false prophets had left. They were saying he's scared. They were saying these apostles, Paul's scared to come down here. Paul's scared to come down here because he know when he come down here, we're going to rake him out in the word, up and down, in and out. They don't know who they was messing with. Paul was a Pharisee of Pharisees. Paul knew how to speak several languages. But Paul said, in my weaknesses, he said, I became humble. He made himself of no reputation so that Jesus would be glorified. He made himself of no reputation. He humbled himself as a servant, in which he was, so that Jesus would be glorified. The measure of faith is enough to please God. His love for us will help us pass every test. Every test. I'm talking about some hard stuff. He'll help us pass it. Some things he'll have us to stay in. Some things he'll have us to get out of. See, just because we're Christians don't mean we're stuck in some mess. We're not stuck in mess. But the same Holy Spirit, as I said before, that raised Christ from the dead, dwells in us. He will help us to do some things that we don't have the strength to do. But through the Holy Spirit power, through his power, through the anointing, through the axe head anointing, he will enable us to do, to say, to make the move. And he'll give us the anointing to stay if he says stay. But when we can hear from God, see, when we are operating in the measure of faith, we can hear from God. We can hear the Holy Spirit say, no, don't say that. No, don't do that. No, don't go there. But when we're not, we're operating on the axe head handle. And we're beating at that tree. We're beating at the tree of our life. And we look over here and we see this one is growing. This one is growing. And that one is growing. And this one is growing over here. And though nobody might not say nothing, but they know you're a baby. And don't nobody want to be no Christian baby. Can I hear somebody say amen?
Amen.
Nobody. Nobody. And so Paul wrote this in his final farewell to the Corinthians church in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11 through 14. He said, finally, brethren. And then he said, farewell. Be perfect. Farewell, brethren. Or finally, brethren. Farewell. Be perfect. Mature. Grow up. Be of good cheer. Be of one mind. Love and peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints salute you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you. Amen. See, Paul, he passed the test. Paul told him, he told him what he needed to say, and then he went on about his business. Lord, I'm not trying to figure out what only you can work out. See, I'm not going to try to figure out what only God can work out. Christian House of Prayer this morning, what I do when the Lord gives me a message for the congregation, sometimes he gives me messages just for me. And then sometimes the message that he gives from the congregation, I know the difference. But usually I write, what is the goal? The goal. What is the goal of this message? Honor the point. The point is this. The measure of our faith that God has given to us is enough faith to please God. And when we take the measure of faith that God has given to us and we apply it to our lives in hopes that the fruit of the Spirit will be manifested in our lives, we will see a change take place. We will see a growth take place. We will see a peace that pass all understanding. We'll see a joy that gives us the strength that we need in order to because there's going to be trials and tribulations that go with our life. But God is the same in the valley as he is on the mountains. He's the same. And so the essence of this message and where we're going, we're heading to confidence, the message of faith first is that before we can operate in confidence, we have to go through this test of faith. And we can pass every test, every one. Even if we mess up, I'm talking about before the self same hour, we should be repenting. We should be getting back on course. So that we can be in right standings with God again. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's just impossible. If you're going to clap, don't just pat the cake. If you're going to pat, just give him the glory, give him the honor. Because he's worthy of all of our expectations. He is worthy. So this morning, Christian House of Prayer, we talked about coming next week because we're going to pray. We're going to pray for the election because either way as go, our country is going to be an unrest. So we want to pray. This church is called the Christian House of Prayer. That means prayer is what we do. And so we're going to come and we're going to pray. We're going to pray for every person. We're going to pray for peace. We're going to pray that God will have his way and that everything is going to be all right. Amen. I love y'all. Hallelujah. I love the Lord, and I won't take it back. He's been too good to me. Every eye closed and every head bowed, if you don't mind. Father, I thank you and give you praise and honor for this congregation, the Christian House of Prayer. And I pray, Father, that as we would begin to leave this place, but never your presence, I'm asking, Father, for you to peruse over this sanctuary. And Father, those that do not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, those that are not born again, Father, I'm praying, dear Lord, through the leading of the Holy Spirit, would prick their heart that they would be able to become a part of your family today. If there's someone here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, if you don't know right now that if you were to die, that you would go to heaven to be with God, because this heaven is a real place. Heaven is real and hell is real. And God did not make hell for his people, for his creations. He made heaven for us after this life. And if you cannot say unequivocally, if you were to die today, that you would go to be with the Lord, then you are in need of a Savior. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19 says, I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Therefore, then he tells us what to choose. He says, therefore choose life, that both you and your seed may live. He said, I lay before you life and death, curses and blessings. And then God says, choose life and live. If there's someone in this sanctuary this morning and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, and you want to know him, you want to know Jesus, would you raise your hand? Would you raise your hand or stand up so I can see you? I want to see who you are. If you need to be born again, you need to be saved. And even there on the streaming, if there's someone there that need to be born again, if you need to be saved, I need you to stand up. I need you to stand up. If there's someone this morning and you're in a backslidden state, in other words, something has separated you between you and your God. It's called backsliding. But God is married to the backslider. He wants you to come back. Come back to the house. Not just come back to the house, but come back to the Father of the house. If you are here this morning and you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, I need you to stand. Stand up. Don't be ashamed. Stand up. I see you. I see. Could you remain standing? Whoever stand up. As a matter of fact, just make your way to the front. Get your belongings and make your way to the front. Those of you that need to rededicate your life back unto the Lord. Hallelujah. If there's someone or anyone here this morning and you're in search of a church home, and you believe that the Christian House of Prayer is the church, the family, this, we want this to be your family, I would be your pastor, then we welcome you. And if you are looking for a church, I will say that we're not perfect, but we love God. We love him. And if you want to be along to a loving church that loves God and growing with him, then I want you to stand up and I want you to come on up. If there's anybody here that want to join the Christian House of Prayer this morning, and you want to join, I see you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God bless you. 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 Let's just wait a couple more minutes. Hallelujah. If you're in a backslidden state, or even last night or last week, and you prayed about it, but it just seemed like you haven't been able to get that breakthrough, we have counselors up here that can minister to you. Thank you, Lord. That's what it's all about. The church is a cleanup house. This is where we clean up ourselves. We clean up our hearts. We clean up our minds. Jesus said, I didn't come for the well. He said, I came for the sick. I came for the ones that know they need me. They know they need me. And so one more time, if there's anyone that needs to come to the altar, don't let the devil steal this moment, because we don't know what the next hour will bring. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I praise you. God bless you, woman of God. Yes. Yes, Jesus loves us that much. Yes, he will leave the 99 and go after that one. Yes, he will. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is that walking with the King? I love that song. He's a good guy. He's a good guy. Everyone that's up here, I want you to put your belongings down. Lift your hands up before the Lord. If you would repeat after me, Father, I come to you today as humbly as I possibly know how, asking you to forgive me of my sins, transgressions, and iniquity. Father, today I'm coming to you, asking you to cleanse me, wash me with your anointing, with your power today. Help me to live this Christian life that you have set me on. I want to know you more. Father, again, forgive me today. And your word said that if I ask you to forgive me, that you will forgive me, and you will throw everything out of my life, my mind, your mind, that has tried to hinder me from walking with you. I today dedicate my life fresh and new. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. And before I take it back, I'll add more to it. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Now, people of God, men and women of God, that might have seemed like that was too easy. No, if you meant that with your heart, God has cleansed you. You are fresh. The sin that you did is gone. The Bible says he puts it in the sea of forgetfulness. He'll never bring it up to you again. And you that join the church, we welcome you to the Christian House of Prayer. Amen. So today, before you all leave, we have ministers, counselors. I just want them to personally get with y'all and just pray with you. They're not going to ask you what it was. That's between you and God. Amen. They just going to pray with you and see if there's anything that we can do to help you or anything that you need. Don't you love him? Don't you love Jesus? Don't you just love him? I tell you. Hallelujah. I just love him. I love the Lord. I love the Lord. Do y'all love him like I love him? Woo! Woo! He's been too good. He's been so good. He's my rock, my shield, in the middle of a wheel. Hallelujah. Who know that song? He's my rock, my soul, my soul, my shield. He's my real. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen. You are dismissed.